Hello, everybody. Welcome to another great episode of Distilled, Brewed, and Reviewed. My name is John. This is my world-famous sipping den, and on this channel, I do everything that has anything to do with alcohol and coffee. I've put together a stellar playlist for you to go into. Check out those titles and get involved in that playlist. You're going to love those playlists. And to make this really easy, every video I do, I pin the first comment because I have a link to the playlist that pertains to what I'm reviewing. In this case, it's going to be bourbon. I have a hell of a bourbon playlist. I've been going through Old Foresters. I've had about 13 different Old Foresters. I was down here, I rearranged this. I did a video on it. I rearranged my shelves over here. Found 13 bottles of Old Forester. Looked at my reviews because sometimes I buy stuff I forget. And I'm sad to admit, out of the 13, I had two. So I'm going through. I've done barrel picks for them and everything. So we're going to get them all done. All right, we're going to get them all done. All the Old Foresters. Let's talk about it a little bit. So this, you see, it says 100 on it. What is that date? 1897. That is the date that the Bottled in Bond Act went into effect, was passed, was put into law. What the Bottled in Bond Act did, it ensured the quality of bourbon. Because at the time, in 1897, there was a lot going on with bourbon. They would add tobacco juice and all kinds of crazy stuff to bourbon to kind of make the flavor better. And it was terrible. And it was dangerous half the time. So they kind of, government went in there, stepped in there. And some of the rules for bottled and bond was that it had to be aged in a federally inspected warehouse, had to be 100 proof, had to be 4 years old. So it had to be 4 years old, had to be 100 proof, 50% alcohol by volume. What are some of the other rules? Had to be made in one distilling season at one distillery. I think that's it. I got it written down here. Yeah, I think that's it. All right. But the beautiful thing about Brown-Forman is that's in 1897, 27 years earlier, in 1870, Brown-Forman was the first one to put their whiskey in sealed bottles to ensure quality and put their name on it and their labels. They were 27 years ahead of this act. So that's cool. Brown-Forman did start in, 1870? Now, George Garvin Brown was one of the ones who founded that. Where they get Forman, that was, he formed it, and then he brought him as a business partner and an accountant. He died in 1901, but they kept the name. The Browns still own 50% of the company. They're on the fifth generation of kind of on the board of the company. I want to hit all the spots. Okay. I just wrote something down. It reminds me what to talk about. Let me see. If you look right here, they spell their whiskey without an E. Now, Maker's Mark does it because that's the way the Scottish do it. There's other countries that do it. Some have the E, some don't. They're both correct here. Either way you want to spell it. Maker's Mark does it as a whatever to their Scottish heritage. They do it because they came out before that became popular to spell it here with the E, so they just kept it. As far as Old Forester, that name, Forester was a friend of, and by the way, Foreman that we talked about, his name was George, so it's easy to remember, like the boxer George Foreman. But Forester, Dr. Forester, was a prominent physician in Louisville, and he was friends with Garvin Brown. And he was really behind using alcohol for medicinal purposes and the fact that he bottled it and improved the quality of it. So he got behind it. So that's where they got that name, Forester. He spelled it with two R's. I think that's about it. Oh, Whiskey Row. So this is considered a Whiskey Row series. There's four of them in the Whiskey Row series because at the time they made this whiskey, originally they were on Main Street in Louisville, and that was considered Whiskey Row because there were 50-something distilleries there at the time. By the way, after Prohibition, there were zero. They're coming back now that I think there's nine as I'm making this. But it's right on the river, and there's a little hill that goes right down to the river from Main Street, and you can roll the barrels right down the hill, load them on the steamships, and take them to wherever they need to go. A lot of times, New Orleans. I can get in the weeds on this story. It's pretty cool. I know a lot about what the distillers did on and off season. There's some cool stories. It's not for this video. I'm just pointing out with the Whiskey Row, and it's called Whiskey Row to this day, and that's why they made the series, the Whiskey Row series. There's four in that series. Maybe five. Some people think the Statesman is part of the Whiskey Row series. Whatever. All right, so let's get into the flavor profile. We'll get into the color, and I'll let you look at that through here so we know it's 4 years old. Can't be less, and it can't be more. give you the color in the glass. Okay, so, and by the way, this is 72% corn, 18% rye, and 10% malted barley. 4 years is an unbelievable amount of time. It's not bad. It's okay. I'm just saying. It takes about a year, 2 years, for really the flavor of the barrel to really get in and make a good change in whiskey. So this is four. People argue that, depending on where it is, this and that. That's an old rule of thumb. Anyway, I've had stuff with a lot more, and I've had a lot of fours and less, and on and on. The reason I'm pointing this out is because this one, for whatever reason, smells very smoky. I think it's a number four char. I think it's number three char. So I don't know why it's more smoky than a lot of whiskeys that I smell that are aged even longer in the brand new oak charred barrel, which bourbon has to be put into. But it is very smoky. If you like smoky, if you want to pair something with barbecue or with bacon, this is your baby right here. I couldn't help it. I'm supposed to do all the nose. I taste it, so I still smell. It has a, so the charcoal, the wood, the smoky, caramelized sugar, cooked apple. And a cinnamon. It's got a pleasant smell. Let's give it a taste again now. That was an acclimation sip. We'll get into the flavor. Again, it is smoky. It's odd that it's that smoky. It's got a slight mint and a slight char. It's almost like a peppermint patty. Not as strong, but there's the slight flavor of the chocolate and the mint, much like, and it's sweet. So not real sweet, but sweet enough. Again, caramel, something where you've cooked brown sugar, get that smokiness, get that cooked apple. You get the little bit of the chocolate and the mint, what I call peppermint patty in this case. Got toffee type smell or taste. It's going for about $50 now. I've had this a while. It's a shame I could have put this out. But I'm getting them out now. Anyway, that's the main flavor profile of this. So, if it sounds good to you, give it a shot. At the end of this, I'll roll them all up and do them blind for you. I'll try it, and maybe I'll try and guess what ones are which. But I'll certainly tell you which I taste in them and what I think's better than the other. All right. Get through these first, and then we'll do that. I'll see you on the next one.